This is Nick Asayan, CEO Light Helmets, and this is Light Impact, Season 2, Episode 1, Aren't You Lucky? Got a special guest today, Southern California, father, entrepreneur, second pick of the 1993 draft. Played for the Seahawks, Bears, Raiders, and some other fine teams in the league. Rick Mirer, thanks for joining us today.
Thank you, Nick. It's good to be here.
I think we had a story written about Light probably 4+ years ago. And I don't remember if you emailed me or you found me on LinkedIn. Do you recall how that whole interaction started?
I love that we didn't prepare for this because I have to remember things live. I read it in the paper. I think it was the Rancho Review, the little paper. And I must have emailed you.
I think you emailed me.
But I was very curious with what's going on with the helmet game and all the developments and stuff. And, it just took off from there.
I think we had just started. And if I remember, I had gone to one of my partners and I'm like, holy shit, Rick Mirer just emailed me. And we're going to go meet at like Cafe, you know,
Positano. Yeah.
And get a cup of coffee. And I don't remember if your father came or... He may have, or we talked to him at some point.
Yeah, he was in. That's right. They were in town, and he's an old coach. So I mean, I was reaching out as a parent, not a player.
Yeah,
you know. And then as the concerns have grown with the, you know, all the concussion stuff, and it made sense to my old man too. So yeah, he was curious.
Yeah, no, and you've been a good sport throughout, and you know, making some introductions and helping us along the way, and you certainly get it. So it's great having you here today. I was pretty excited about this. I know we've been bugging you about trying to get you in here, so thanks for coming in. So talk a little bit about, you know, your dad was your coach, but where did you grow up, and what sports did you start to play when you were young?
I grew up in Goshen, Indiana, which is, call it 30 miles from South Bend, so Notre Dame was close for me. But my dad was not my coach. He was the coach before I got to high school.
Oh.
So he coached almost 20 years, won state championship, went to another, had a great coaching career, did you know, coached baseball as well before that. But, he got out when I was coming in, which was weird to me as a 15-year-old kid. It kind of came out of nowhere, but he just decided it was time to make a change for himself, and he didn't want to coach me. I think he thought we were going to be pretty good and it would just be easier on me.
Sure.
Which is exactly what happened, and he was right. And I know we've both felt like it was the best decision all this time. And we had a strong program, and he knew we had a good class, and he was honestly ready to make a change just for his own, you know, his own well-being. But he got into some business and banking and stayed in town, obviously, but he was the parent wearing the, you know, headphones listening to the game on the radio, so he wouldn't hear the other parents
and all screaming
the,
at you,
chatter. Yeah, so it was hard, I think, for him to sit in the stands, because it's hard for me to sit in the stands these days. But as a parent, it's a lot different than as somebody on the sideline who's invested in the game and has control of what's happening in the game a little bit. But it was a good move, and it made sense. Like I said, it was odd to hear it at first. I'm like, what are you talking about? We've been working toward this all this time. But you know, it was good. It took all the pressure off. You know, dinner table wasn't barking at me about the way we practiced or, you know, played. It was more about support.
I wonder how the new coach that took over felt, right? Did he feel like he was under the microscope?
He had coached with my dad and for my dad, left, took a head job in Shelbyville, Indiana also, so came back. And I'm not going to say my dad got to pick the coach, but I do think he influenced the decision. So I was in good hands. I mean, this was a lifelong friend of our family and somebody who knew me when, you know, I was crawling around on the floor. So it was a good fit. It was perfect. The rest of the staff, there was former players and guys that obviously were connected to my dad, and they kind of call my dad the godfather of that program.
That's cool.
And, it was a very smooth and easy transition.
Did you play other sports, or was football your primary?
Football was primary. Baseball was probably equal. Basketball was kind of mandatory for Indiana kids.
Sure.
Growing up. I didn't play high school basketball. There just wasn't enough time to satisfy all the coaches with all the time, you know, constraints. But I missed basketball, but I continued to play baseball. And I missed baseball still. I mean, I strongly considered baseball in college, it really was going to come down to warm weather or cold weather campus. If I'd have wound up at Stanford or Florida State or somewhere like that, I probably would have done both. But it was too hard to try to do it at Notre Dame with all the baseball travel.
Sure.
You know, spending all spring in Florida and everywhere else when I needed to be on campus doing all the spring stuff.
Did you like football better?
Not really. I mean, it turned out to be something that wound up being a huge part of my life. But honestly, on a day-to-day basis, I really, really liked baseball. And I, you know, now I'm surrounded by a bunch of retired baseball guys, MLB guys, and pitchers and hitters and everything in between, managers now. It's just fun to still talk baseball. There's very different the way the intensity part of it goes, I guess, you know, 16 games versus 162. But it was always whatever season we were in is what I was into.
Sure.
And that included basketball until I was freshman in high school.
When did you know you were good, right? You know, there's kids that play high school football that don't play. Then there's kids that play high school football that are decent, but they're not going to play at the next level. And I think the number now is somewhere between 5 and 7% of kids end up going to play college. When did you know you were good or I don't want to say different, but that you were going to play at the next level?
Well, yeah, I was a little old for my class. I had an advantage that way. I was always pretty good, but I never knew if I was good enough to play after high school until I got into high school. And honestly, I didn't know anybody else who did. You know, there weren't a lot of kids coming out of our town or our school that went on and played on Saturdays or Sundays. There's a few, but it really wasn't a realistic thing to think about as a young kid. It's funny now, these guys, you know, not only do they get offers when they're in the eighth grade, but they, you know, at 7 years old, they start, they're like, you know, planning on it. And that should be reserved for golf and tennis and some of those sports. But now it's quarterbacks and pitchers. So I had a great class. We had a good program. I benefited from great coaching and winning. And that to me was, I just kept marching on. And it really came down to, are you big enough? You know,
sure.
I think that if you're, you know, 5'5", it's hard to play in the NFL, but
yeah,
but I had a growth spurt. I'm not a real big guy, but I was big enough. And, that was kind of the deciding thing. And then, you know, once you get a few stats and your team wins and the colleges start calling and, you know, went to a few camps, you find out how you stack up against the other guys that are also getting attention. So I just kept running with it, and we kept winning, and it was just good all the way around.
So today, you know, I got a kid that's 16. He actually played with your son a couple of years back when the school won open in California for football. And the interesting thing now is you have huddle. You have all this film.
Right.
You have all these different camps, and the internet and social media has changed things completely. And some of these kids are – just focused on single sport now versus playing all of these different sports. What's your gut now when you look back at when you were playing three sports versus some of the kids now that are so focused on one sport? What are your thoughts?
Well, I'm a huge proponent of multiple sports. I think two or three is hard, but it's just more well-rounded. I think it's just better athletically. I think it's better for your mind just to get a break and do something competitive but different. So, you know, I mean, looking back, if I just played football all year round, I don't think I'm any better than I was. And I don't think I just probably would have burned out or been kind of frustrated.
Sure.
And get bored. So changing it up was great. And I know people do it and they're getting away with it. Honestly, you could probably never even play tackle football and get recruited now. I mean, if you run real fast and you 7-on-7 stuff, I mean, sometimes the specs take care of it, and they figure they can teach you the rest. But my kids all played multiple sports. I tell everybody I can or that who asks, you know, I would encourage that.
Sure.
Even though you think you're getting a little bit behind in something else, I think it's maybe a little different with golf or tennis or something that's really specific and if you're in a warm weather place. But, yeah, I just I would never have done it differently. I wouldn't want my boys to have done it differently. And they wound up playing specialized things, but I think they're better athletes because they play all these sports on the side as well.
Yeah.
Pick up hoops or golf or anything else, pickleball now. I mean, all kinds of different stuff. Sure. I think it all helps.
Yeah, I agree with that. You know, there's so much of it is Jordan Palmer's involved in our company. And one of the things is at his QB summit that they work on is filming these guys and how are you starting? How are you stopping? You see all these injuries now that are non-contact injuries. And some of it's the turf. Some of it's, you know, you have a weakness or a prior injury. But a lot of this stuff is, hey, we're trying to get guys to start and stop and change directions with the lower part of their body, not the upper part, and that's what's causing these injuries. They're training people to do this, but I think you learn a lot of that playing all of these other sports. Surface is different in basketball, mm-hmm. way different in, you know, tennis, or it's way different in baseball. So I think in the past, being able to play those different sports just give you better control. So you were a better football player by playing different sports.
I believe that. I think athletes are athletes, you know, and it's you can fine tune the specifics when you specialize in certain things. But being athletic, being able to move, being able to react, transition, you know, all that stuff, things happen fast.
Yeah.
And I think intuitively the people that play multiple sports just react and it works. If you're trying to calculate every move because you don't really have the athletic, you know, know-how, it's a little robotic.
Sure.
Forced.
Yep. Yep. And you can only coach so much. There's a certain amount that just, it's like a computer hard drive. It gets developed over time and it you know, it learns as it goes. And the human brain's the same way. And I think the best athletes are the ones that have had the most programming that, you know, inherently they can communicate with their body to be able to make those reactions, changes, and perform at a high level.
I agree.
When you were wrapping up your junior year, senior year, when did you entertain going to Notre Dame, right? Because obviously hometown boy, what were your other options on the table? And talk us through that decision-making process.
I'd say a lot happened my junior year. We had a big statistical season. I didn't play a lot as a sophomore. Played a little defense, kicked off, did some other things, punted.
You played defense?
Yeah, I was a safety. And that's where I fit in. As a sophomore, that's where I could get on the field. But as a junior, I got to play quarterback the whole time. We were pretty good. Did some stuff in the summer, went to camp at Michigan, went to camp in Indiana. Didn't really know Notre Dame that well yet at the time, but I'm right down the street, and we're sort of sharing the same nightly news and highlights of high school games.
Sure.
And stuff. So they happen to be really, you know, turning into a dominant program with Coach Holtz, getting ready for that 88 national championship season. So, yeah, I'd say between junior and senior year, there was a lot of attention and offers and stuff started coming in. But I didn't narrow it down until into the season. You know, my last – it was Michigan and Notre Dame at the end. But I was – you know, I went to UCLA and Florida State was huge on my list. And I didn't really care about staying close to home. It just worked out that the two teams that made most sense for me happened to be pretty close.
Sure. That's pretty cool. Did coaches come to your home? I mean, I've watched these 30s for 30s, and you see these crazy stories or Barry Switzer showing up, yeah, somewhere and in a fur coat, you know, asking for XYZ player. Like, did that stuff happen?
Yeah, a lot. Yeah, I mean, you can control it. They weren't unannounced. But you literally got a letter in the mail. I mean, it was a hard copy, you know, we're interested in talking to you kind of thing.
Sure.
Come to the camp or I mean, getting film required going through the coach and making a tape. So there was some of that.
Sure.
You know, we didn't have huddle. We didn't have internet. I
yep.
mean, none of that really was happening. So they had to do their homework, and they had to send people to go watch you play. And once they saw kind of the eyeball test, I guess, and maybe how you act on the sideline, the little things when they're actually at the game.
Sure.
It kind of took off from there. But, yeah, plenty of coaches came through. I visited those schools I mentioned. You know, really considered baseball a part of the equation. It mattered to me who the coaches were and their stability. I mean, really, the thing with Michigan was Bo Schembechler's health was not very good.
Yeah.
And I didn't want to be a part of there when a coaching change happened. So that honestly was a huge factor. I had good choices. So, I mean, I think it would have been fine either way with a couple other schools too, but it was really a big deal when they came to your school or especially to your home. it really felt like they cared. And that was how it happened. And now, you know, these guys jet set around and they go visit these kids all over the country, and it's pretty common. But there weren't many private jets and things like that back then. So it was, you know, road trips for these guys.
Sure. And how was it? I mean, were your parents involved like a lot, a little? Did they give you free rein to kind of make your own decision? Were they advisors? Like, because you see all sorts of different levels of intervention by folks today.
They saw everything that happened because it came through the mail. Guys visited the house, things at school. You know, the coach is important too because they're really dealing with the coach and talking about what's this kid like, or,
sure,
you know, what are the grades like and stuff like that. There was nothing going on. I mean, there was no DM and social media kind of interaction with recruiting guys. It was all really phone calls and mail and then a visit if you did that in the summer. So I went to camp in Michigan and took most of my offense the summer between junior senior year, and we had a huge fun event, you know, staying in the dorms, competing, had like 7-on-7 stuff. So it was, I got quite a bit of attention at that one, but it was good to be out there with the rest of the best guys.
What did you, so when you got to Notre Dame, you made that decision. Coach Holtz was the coach at the time when you got there?
Correct.
And obviously he's not only well-respected in football and across all sports as a coach, but also as a motivator and as a leader. Talk a little bit about him as a guy, your experience with him, and what you learned from him.
Well, he was coming off a national championship when I went in as a freshman. So I guess the recruiting process started before that. But he had a great reputation. He said the right things to the parents, which is huge. School matters there. It was very important to finish. You know, it was about graduating. No one talked about playing 3 years and moving on. No one talked about transferring. Mm-hmm. I mean, it was a very different time. But it was a serious thing. You know, of course, the sales pitch and the recruiting process is a little different than the first day you actually have the stuff on and you run out to practice and now they're yelling at you. And
sure.
It's like, okay, everything changed.
Nobody's kissing your butt anymore.
No more of that. But that was expected and that was fine. And mostly I just felt, you know, I think all of the guys I played with would say the same thing. Like, it attracted the right people, similar people, you know, like-minded guys that wanted to work hard and didn't really care about the flash. We played in bad weather. We knew what we were getting into. Didn't love and enjoy, you know, practicing in the rain and stuff like that. But,
sure.
You know, we put in the work, and he was kind of a no-nonsense guy that way, and nothing changed the whole time. He was there 11 years. I was right in the middle of those 11, and I don't think he did anything different the last year that he did the first year.
Yeah, it's, you know, I was I'm a little older than you. I'm 56, you're
52.
Yeah, so I guess I'm a lot older than
you. I'm almost 53 there.
And, you know, Coach Holtz, you'd watch and you were like, gosh, you know, the guy's got it buttoned up, right? You know, and Notre Dame has always had this reputation. But you were playing with a lot of other talented guys. With the people that you played with, who stands out in your mind is, man, this guy was the star. I mean,
there were a lot. The first one that came to mind is Bryant Young, who's a recent Hall of Famer.
Yeah.
Pro Football Hall of Fame. But there were a ton of guys. I mean, when I, you know, Rocket Ishmael was a huge thing. Tony Rice, when I got there, Derek Brown was the tight end. You know, Reggie and Tony Brooks were running backs. Todd Light, first rounder. I mean, there was year after year we had strong classes and great personalities, but it's endless. I mean, Aaron Taylor, you know, Bobby Taylor, we had it all covered. And, for the most part, I mean, everybody got along. I mean, it was we sort of look at it like we suffered together in these old dorms, and we didn't really have football dining, you know, not quite the same as it is today with
sure.
some of the treatment. But we won, and I think winning takes care of a lot of the pain. Even when we were playing a team we should beat pretty easily, Coach made us feel like we had to play a perfect game, and that was on purpose, and it worked, and we got used to it. We were honest with the recruits. We didn't tell them it was going to be easy if you come. I mean,
yep.
it's hard. So, you know, nothing changed. And, you know, we've usually finished very strong. A couple of years we we kind of gave one away in the middle somewhere, and it cost you some ranking. I feel like we would have been a really good playoff type team. They didn't have the playoff then, but we won our bowl games. And guys get hurt, and you lose a few pieces along the way. But we played for each other, and we played hard.
Sure. Yeah. It. The other component of this is going to school when you're under the microscope. What was that like? Like, you're walking into class after you played on Saturday, you win a big game, or, you have a rough game and you're walking through campus. Maybe you've got some stories about that, but I'd love to hear about it.
It was mostly good. I mean, nobody wants to stand out, right? Like in class, you switch gears. Now you're a student and you're trying to keep up with the curriculum. It wasn't easy.
Yep.
But the student body is very supportive. I mean, it was a huge bump for those guys when we knocked off somebody good, because sure. It was a fun environment around campus, home or away. So I don't remember any bad, there was never a negative thing. I mean, they're probably rolling their eyes maybe when you're not looking, but after a loss here and there, but we didn't have too many. And, a lot of attaboys and good win kind of stuff, good feedback from a big win. But, I don't, not many guys were seeking out attention.
Sure.
You had to do your media stuff. You had a lot, the quarterbacks have a lot of responsibilities with press conference answering questions throughout the week, especially after the game. But, it was just try to get your body back together and start over.
Yeah. Injury wise, did you have anything that was pressing or recurrent while you were at Notre Dame?
No, I had a broken rib and missed one start at Purdue, but I was lucky. I mean, I had bumps and bruises and felt terrible sometimes, but honestly, nothing serious, no knees, no surgeries, just bumps and bruises and hurt feelings once in a while, but that comes with the territory.
What do you think about, like, I look back and I probably wouldn't even be sitting here with you right now if there were camera phones and social media when I was in college. Like, I played for a short period of time at a relatively small school, but if you rewound the tape, how does your life look differently if there were camera phones?
I think we would have acted different knowing, and I think that's what these kids now need to worry about. Like, be careful in public with your behavior. But yeah, there's plenty of things that you wouldn't want the world to see. Just being kids, you're 19, 20 years old, 21, and on. But that didn't, it was the same. That's the same story in the NFL for a bunch of years. I mean, we didn't have all the cameras, and thank God we didn't.
I want to get to these stories. So one of the things that everybody has heard of and seen, and I think it's 30 for 30 or Football Life or something like that, was the Catholic versus convicts playing the Hurricanes. And we actually had a guy that was on the scout team of the Hurricanes here, and, we bring up the story, and he would laugh and, give his iteration of it. How did that whole thing play out from, where you were in your perspective?
Well, there was only a three-year series, and they were battles, and there's brawls, and it was very competitive. We had a lot of respect for Miami, and I think they probably say the same because we had to fight it out every time. But the 88 game before I got there was a back-and-forth thing, and I got a chance to be a part of one of those as a starter in 91, and we beat them at home. But, when we drive into the Orange Bowl, they're trying to knock our bus over. I mean, this is the fan base or whatever, the crowd around it, not the players. But, they had a big attitude, and we had same, and they were in conflict.
Sure.
They definitely weren't it wasn't a friendly environment to go there. It's much easier to play in South Bend. I mean, it's a pretty calm crowd, but a very proud crowd. And, the T-shirt happened. It became a thing. I mean, all these years later, they still talk about it. But it was fun. I mean, we had great rivalries with several different places, SC, Michigan. I mean, Penn State was tough for us. Of course, Navy always, every year for forever now.
Sure.
But there was something different about playing the Hurricanes, and I think they feel the same, and it was good. I think it was just good TV, and I'm glad it happened. It was fun.
Were they more physical, do you feel, than anyone else, or was there more – shit talking and everything else in those games?
It was more the language. Yeah, I wouldn't call them the most physical team because they were fast and they were explosive, and they stretched the field and there was a lot of dramatic plays and stuff. But when I think of physical, I think of Michigan or Penn State,
sure.
Just because it's, you know, we kind of felt like we were playing ourselves. I mean, yeah. It was very similar. But yeah, I mean, to go to Florida. I mean, we played in the Orange Bowl a couple times, and it was a treat just to go get out of the bad weather,
right.
Late in the year. So, you know, it was a fast track when we played down there, and then they complained about our grass was like 3 inches long and slow on purpose, and it probably wasn't on purpose, but it's just how we could do it or how they decided to do it. So, yeah, I mean, they're just two conflicting kind of styles of play, and you know, that's what's fun about it. I mean, I wish that rivalry would have kept going. I think they were independent still at the time. That hasn't changed for us, but other places have kind of made moves around different conferences, so the scheduling stuff's a nightmare. But it was exciting. It was fun. I was glad to be a part of it.
Yeah, that's fun stuff. I mean, even, you know, sometimes at night they'll be rerunning those games, and you watch them, and you're like, man, you know, football was different.
Yeah.
It was a lot more, I don't want to say more violent, because it's a violent game, but the things that were not relegated out of the game back then, you know, leading with the head and all of these hits over the middle, and what they could do to the quarterback. I mean,
yeah. Well, taunting, how about that? They were pros at that, and it was great. I mean, it got them going, and we had to react, and we weren't allowed to, I don't know, coach didn't want us to pick fights and kind of act that way, but we had to deal with it. And
sure.
It was just a street fight, and it was fun.
Yeah. Well, that's good stuff. That's good stuff. Have you ever connected with any of the guys from those teams when you were in the NFL or in later parts of life? Were you just about this stuff?
Yeah. Gino Toretta is a buddy, and we did some time together in Seattle. Actually as teammates, we stayed in touch. It's not a lot of interaction, but we laugh about it. And he won the Heisman that year and threw all those touchdowns to Lamar Thomas and all those guys. So, yeah, I mean, I played against a ton of Miami guys, not with that many, actually. But, yeah, they're still sort of like the stare-down kind of thing when it's certain guys from that era. But, you know, I won against Ray Lewis a bunch of times, and he was a little bit younger. But, I mean, amazing player.
Yeah.
And everybody knows that.
What was it like playing that guy? Like, his level of intensity was off the chart.
Yeah, and they kind of, you know, Baltimore kind of had the same swagger as the U. You know, it was a little bit, and it's him. I mean, I think that's how it happened. Ed Reed, too, I suppose.
Sure.
But, yeah, I mean, nothing but respect for guys like that. He played hard, you know, he played fair, and he's an intimidating-looking guy, and for a good reason. I
sure.
mean, he did, there was no off plays. So once in a while when we beat him, felt pretty good.
Yeah. Watching his training regiment, you know, as he aged was crazy. I mean, he'd be on the bike and the lifting, and guys like James Harrison from the Steelers. I ran into him at Omni La Costa, and I go into the steam room, and it was before the season started. This is like, I don't know, 10 years ago, 12 years ago. And he's in there in like a rubber suit and he's doing push-ups. And I'm like, hey, he's a very large human being, and B, usually when you go into a steam room, like as guys, like there's a pecking order, just like when you walk up to urinals, right? Like you don't sit in a certain space, and he's in there doing push-ups and he's doing body weight squats, and I'm like, what are you doing? And he goes, man, it's hot down in Miami. He's like, I gotta get ready.
You and I go in there, it's like we're going to the spa. He goes in there and he's angry.
Exactly. Yeah. You know, I'm sitting over on the side and I'm talking, having a conversation with him. It was a little bit weird, but intense guys, and I want to talk a little bit about that and some of the characters that you played against in the NFL, but I want to go to, before we get to that draft day for you, so you watch, the draft now has become commercialized like everything else,
yeah.
Right? I mean, the combine now is commercialized. We went to the combine, I must have been 2020, and we had just taken ownership of SG Helmets, converted it to light. And yeah, I'm standing there in a steakhouse, and it's jammed, right, because it's all guys. And the security's different there than it is at, like, a regular game. And Dan Marino was standing there, and he had a glass of Chardonnay, and I'm like, getting pushed over closer to him. And you get too close to someone, you have to introduce yourself because it's just uncomfortable. And I'm like, hi, I'm Nick Cassini, Light Helmets. He's like, Dan Marino. And it's like, I wasn't going to say it. Yeah, of course you're Dan Marino. But he had a glass of Chardonnay in his hand, and I'm like, you're a pussy. And he looks at me, and I look at his wine glass, and I'm like, what's that? And he goes, I can drink harder than this. And we both laughed, and that was it. But, you know, everything now is commercialized. Everything is commercialized. But the draft, like, you know, you watch the Aaron Rodgers saga of him sitting there right. And going through all these. So you got drafted second in the first round, correct?
Yes.
And what was the run-up to that? And were you talking to teams? Were you nervous? I mean, I'd love to hear a little bit about that.
Well, it was a lot different. I didn't even go. It wasn't required. It wasn't for TV. I mean, it was a procedure to get some business done. But, yep. You know, they played it up a little bit. That was just kind of the beginning of some of what it's become. But what Drew Bledsoe and I both knew months before was that the two teams picking first and second were taking the two of us. That was kind of just the way it was.
Yep.
And I guess it could have changed. But so it was just a matter of which was going where. And we didn't know until it happened. I didn't know. Drew, you know, says he had no idea. He felt maybe, you know, one way or the other. But I'm at my parents' house in the family room watching on TV like everybody else. And then, boom, you know, then it's all interviews and get flights figured out and got to go to Seattle right away. But it wasn't that stressful. I think it can be and is for if you're deeper in the draft and all that. But now, you know, I feel for the guys sitting at those tables and the cameras on them and they're just talking about the next 10 teams and how long it might be till.
Yeah.
And I never wanted to be in that position and really didn't even consider doing it. I suppose now if it was, you know, same thing had it happened now, we would be required to be there. But I'm glad it went the way it did. And it was just a formality
sure.
for me. I mean, the combine's the same thing. I mean, it's a medical check. It can be a workout, but we weren't – Drew threw, but I didn't throw. We did some of the stuff, but it's more interviews and medical. And so I went and participated some of it and was advised to do this and not that. Just there's no reason for some of it. So, yeah, it was – we didn't really think twice about how it worked then. And now I watch, and it's a circus. I mean, it's crazy, but – it's entertaining, and football, people love football. I mean, they want to watch as much of it as they can, regardless. I mean, I think that Hard Knocks is cool. I mean, I never thought that was possible, that they'd let cameras in and teams would agree to that. But sure. It's good TV, and there's people just eat it up.
Yeah. Growing up and watching, I grew up in Racine, Wisconsin, the Milwaukee area. So the Packers were always big, but all there was live TV. Everything was,
right.
There was no streaming. There was no internet. There was no, like, my parents bought me probably at Zaya or Target or one of these stores, like, where you got the whole uniform, right? And you got the plastic the kid, shit helmet yeah. with the Bart Starr face mask. And I had Barty Smith's jersey. I didn't even know what the hell Barty Smith was. Like, I had to go to the library to go and look in a book to make that determination. And I'm standing there, you know, I got a picture of me holding the orange Nerf football. You didn't have exposure to what personalities were like or anything else, right? And
right.
Every once in a while, like NFL films, once they came out, they'd have the Follies or things like that to give you a little dose of personality. So you get drafted and you jump on a flight, you go to Seattle. What is that process like walking in there, and who's the coach, who greets you? What does it feel like in the locker room as a young dude showing up with a bunch of professionals?
Well, you know, there was quite a bit of time to lead up to that with the interview stuff and just hypothetical, you know, situations, which, cause I knew that the Patriot crew just the same, and it was just, you know, how is it going to play out? So Tom Flores was the head coach and drafted me. Larry Kennan was the coordinator who I'd spent time with. Good, great guys. I mean, gentlemen of the league. I mean, it was, you know, tough situation, but good people with good resumes. The Nordstroms didn't own the team anymore. It was Ken Baring, kind of new to that, more of a real estate guy and developer. Didn't know him at the time, but, you know, land, get all the friendly, you know, greetings and stuff, and kind of, it's a lot of names and it's a lot of moving parts. I knew some of the guys on the team, didn't know anything about the city or very little. I liked the music that was there. I mean, yeah. I knew that, and that's pretty much all I could picture. I knew it rained a lot.
just a lot
from
of
what
coffee.
I heard. Yeah, I learned to drink coffee that first year. But it's just a whirlwind of media stuff and a quick mini camp and get to kind of meet some of the teammates. And then, you know, you go back home and, you know, you have a whole calendar of when you're expected to be where. And you know, your next step is figure out housing and how, you know, how that's going to work. So it went fast. It's kind of crazy. Fortunately, I didn't have class my last semester as a senior. I graduated in December.
Okay.
So I finished, which was awesome because it just freed me up. You could only do so much football stuff. I mean, it's more year round now than it used to be,
yep.
but I didn't need to be there full time, right away, which is good. Cause it's, you know, 22 years old or something, 23, I guess. And had a lot to figure out, but you know, with the football stuff took care of itself and it's like, be here and here's what day and what time and it all goes from there. So I just had a lot to learn and it took, you know, I didn't have to be there immediately, but to get ready to have training camp and stuff, there was some planning, but I was excited to go there. It was fun. It was like this is what we've been working towards.
Sure.
You know, whichever coast it was going to be was, you know, up to those guys. So, that's pretty much the same everywhere. I mean, it just, the team was 2-14. That's the problem the previous year. And it had a long way to go, especially on offense. So, I had to catch up quick.
So, and this sounds ridiculous, but the music scene, right? Seattle's like, we're getting out of the big-haired 80s metal of, you know, Winger and Def Leppard and all that, and we're going into the, you know, Nirvana, Pearl Jam.
Yeah.
People hadn't heard music like that yet. No. And it was all emanating from there. Like, do you kind of get immersed in that scene because you're there and you're young? Like,
yeah, I think even if you didn't know it, you couldn't avoid it. But I knew it and I liked it and I was a fan of that. So the timing was awesome that way. I mean, there was plenty, and there's these, you know, grimy little places, hole in the wall kind of places. Those guys would show up and play before they go on tour, or some of them were just, you know, becoming household names. So Pearl Jam would be the big one, but you know, Soundgarden and Alice in Chains and
sure.
Nirvana and stuff were established. And I'm like, man, you know, whenever they're playing, I'd like to find out, you know, if we can maybe make that. So we caught quite a bit of that, which was fun. And that was the comfortable part of it. You know,
sure.
that was a lot of fun.
Who did you hang out with when you first got there? Like, who were your guys? Because you're new, right?
Yeah, totally new. You know, you're with the other quarterbacks the most, just because of the job description. So that's Stan Gilbaugh and Dan McGuire, great buddies and very supportive. I mean, we're all competing, but I think they knew, you know, I'm gonna play if I can.
Yep.
And Dan was coming off a hip surgery, but he was probably the closest friend I had for a long time. Maybe he wound up moving on, but other guys in my class, draft class, and you know, Cortez Kennedy was the ringleader, Miami guy, defensive player of the year, and he was a hoot. Brian Blades was our receiver, another Miami guy. So you kind of just get thrown into it, you know. And the weirdest thing, the first day at minicamp, I'm taking snaps from Ray Donaldson, who's in his like 17th or 18th year, and his daughter's in college.
Wow.
And I'm like, this is the biggest, this is, it's not how fast everything is, and you know, the magnitude of the media at that level compared to college for me, that wasn't actually, that was less. It was I'm playing with a guy who's 20 years older than me almost, you know? So that was crazy. And I'm just the kid. They're like, come on, kid, like figure it out.
Sure. Sure. Do you think, I mean, you look at like Brady, right? He's 45, 47, whatever his age is. I don't remember off the top of my head. But he's playing with guys that are 21, 22 years old, like he played with their dads, right?
Yeah.
How does that dynamic even work in the locker room?
It doesn't happen much, so that's one thing. I mean, that whole story is fascinating to me, just to have the, you know, the ability to get excited to play again, you know, at that far into your career. But it has to be weird. I mean, when I stopped, I was 34, and the young guys were just like young, you know, and that's 10, you know, I think Tom's 46, so 45 or 46. So I mean, a whole decade longer, and he's him, you know. I mean, they're looking, they had his poster, and you know, they watched all these Super Bowls. So Yeah, that's got to be crazy. And I, that's why I you know, I'm glad he retired. I think it's good that he, you know, shut it down while you're still in one piece. But, yeah. But the, you know, these last few years just extending it, I keep thinking, man, it's crazy. You know, yep. The guys are getting younger and you're getting older.
Yeah. The thing that is remarkable is, A, you're twice as the age of some of the kids that are playing, right? And you're he's still playing at a competitive level.
Yeah.
And he was pretty resilient in terms of injury. Now, the rules are a lot different than they were. I think the one NFL record that'll never be broken is Favre playing 300 consecutive games without missing a game, right? Like
missing a start.
Yeah. Yeah. How's that going to ever happen?
Know. It won't. I mean, it won't. I mean, they won't. It's kind of like pitchers, how many they shut them down after so many innings. Brett played hurt a lot. I don't think guys, you know, unless it's a Super Bowl or a big playoff game or something, they just don't play through some of the stuff he did.
Yeah.
But he's not normal. I mean, he's kind of a savage when it comes to just pain. Fighting through pain. And he's a, you know, one of the greatest competitors I was ever around.
Did you spend much time with him?
Yeah, a whole season in
Green Bay. That's right.
Yeah, in 98 and then some in 99 before I got traded to New York. But, yeah, we played golf and off-season stuff. But during the season, had to put him back together after every Sunday. It was a beating.
Yep. When you got to Seattle, now you're making some money. Like, now everything's structured on how much money you can make in the first round, second round, third round. What were the first things that you bought?
I didn't do anything, really. I mean, I had a car deal. I didn't really spend money on cars. I never really have. It wasn't that much money. Now that you see the numbers compared to today, but I don't know. I mean, I guess I got a little lead in. We also got some, you know, for the trading card companies, you get some cash like to do certain pick which ones you're going to work with. So that had happened months before. So I mean, you know, $100,000 felt like a bazillion dollars. Like,
sure.
So another number. I actually didn't even get a signing bonus at the beginning. It was deferred. This was the first year of the salary cap. And the rookie minimum, the rookie structure was they were figuring out how that was going to work. So there were a lot of loopholes in our contracts, or we had to get creative. So I didn't have this big, you know, windfall of money at the beginning. Yeah. It was coming. I mean, it was in the contract. But yeah, I didn't splurge. I mean, I'm sure there were things. I guess clothes, just stuff you just need to go about kind of that next progressing.
Being in that circle. Yeah. Did you you kind of get thrust into, I mean, you already were in the focus at Notre Dame, but now NFL, the difference in terms of when you're out and about, attention paid, good, bad, and otherwise, what was it like being 22 and kind of tossed into it? You couldn't go anywhere without being at least, I don't want to say interrupted, but recognized.
You know, I blend in pretty well, I think, compared to some guys. As far as the media stuff goes, I mean, there was more at our college games. I mean, it was, you know, we play in the Coliseum, it's full of people, 100,000, and then we go play the Raiders a year later, and there's 40,000.
Yeah.
It was just a different, I'm representing a different team, you know, it's like a totally different thing. But, yeah, I mean, I'd get recognized here and there, but not crazy. I mean, it wasn't hiding, but, it was manageable. Like, you know, and again, people aren't taking your picture. You're not doing all these selfies and stuff back then. You didn't have all that. People pretty much gave you your privacy. But you know, they'd see you, and, you know, coming in and out of the stadium was different. You signed some stuff and then always stop for the kids and everything. But yeah, I guess in the off season, some of the charity golf things and some of those kinds of appearances are, you know, full of the fan types. They have photos and cards and stuff to sign. It's all ready. They know you're coming. And I, you know, I never really loved that part of it, but I always wanted to give time to the kids or people who are respectful and just, you know, kind of make them smile. That felt good.
That's good stuff. So you get drafted early, and you usually end up on a team that's not doing exceptionally well, right? So you get to Seattle, and they weren't as bad as like the late 70s Tampa Bay Buccaneers that didn't win for like 3 years, but. I think, was it Chuck Knox? Was it Coach Pryor? I don't recall. And then Flores, right? And he's now, you know, in the Hall of Fame. And he had come from Oakland and won a Super Bowl prior to that. You show up, and you're coming from a winning college, you know,
Yeah.
Probably one of the most notable colleges. And now you're on a team that's struggling. How does that transition, as well as you're stepping into a team that's not doing well, and you're also, I would guess that the pace of the game is just a lot faster. How did you manage all of that?
Yeah, I think the very hardest part of it was the culture. You know, having been around only winning my whole life to a organization that hasn't had that. And not that they're satisfied, but they're just kind of used to it. And, you know, winning 6 or 8 games was a huge deal. Like, it was like, wow, it's like so different than the 2-14. You must lose 10 in a row. Like, it's like miserable. And I feel for teams every year. I see that. I know how that is on Wednesdays and Thursdays, and it's awful. So, that was hard. I mean, you fight that. You hate that. It's hard. You can't just muscle through it and overcome it yourself. I mean, it requires a lot of things falling in place. I felt like we made really good progress. There were things that just needed to change. But the expectation wasn't what I was used to. And that was hard.
Yeah.
And, Tom Flores, he's been in Super Bowls as a player and a coach. I mean, he's a winner, and he's trying to fix this thing. And they only gave him my first two years, and then they made a change, and then you start over, which was also hard. So, yeah, it became very clear early that it's business. This isn't, you're not playing for your school. You're not all really on the same. You're not from the same background. You didn't choose to be here.
Yeah.
The same way you are when you're recruited and you pick a school. So that was very different. The speed of the game wasn't, to me, like that big a deal.
Wasn't that big of an adjustment?
No, the guys were just older. I mean, guys are 10, 15 years in. I mean, that, like, grown men instead of, you know, guys that are still changing. But, I think just the expectation and the culture was the biggest change.
Is that, now I'm assuming you're talking to your father during this period of time about that. Like, you see these guys that'll go out in social media and they torch their teammate. Russell Wilson this year had a tough go of it, right?
Yep.
And I don't know why that was. I don't know if it was a he issue, if it was a coaching issue, it was a combination of all the above, but one of the defensive guys walking out and giving him an earful. And as the quarterback, you know, you get a lot of credit, but you also get all the blame. And that is challenging. How did you vent and cope with that? Because you can't, like, flick a switch, like you said earlier. It's not just up to you.
Yeah.
How do you deal with that?
I think the guys in the locker room know what happens. You know, the sometimes you have a bad day. Sometimes you play fine and you lose. You miss a kick, your defense, whatever. Something doesn't go right. Or you're playing somebody that's really good in a tough environment. But, I guess quarterback is a unique spot. You get way too much credit and way too much blame. And that's kind of one of the things you have to live with. I mean, my dad, I talked to him, but, like, he wasn't going to fix anything
just a vet,
pat me on the back. Yeah. But, you know, my wife, fiance and wife at the time, like, young, we were still very young. She was stuck with it, you know, and hearing what people say in the stands and stuff like that. And sometimes it's good and that's flattering, but when it's not,
yeah,
it's brutal.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. I mean, skin gets thick fast, right? And
yeah.
There was a kid here from the school our boys went to, and they have a dinner before each game and they have a dinner after each game, which you're also aware of, trying to keep everybody on the same page, but from also getting in trouble.
Yeah.
And it was right before one of their playoff games, and one of the kids was a transfer, he's a quarterback. You know, a lot of eyes on him after another kid that was a quarterback there, your kid, had won a state championship. And they're getting up in front of their teammates, and this kid says, the best thing I ever did was come to school here, but I didn't realize that until I had one of my worst days. And, you know, we're standing there because the dinner's in our company. It's in the assembly place. All the
right.
Kids are lined up with chairs, and he said, I played a rough game. I had a bad game, and I walked out to my car, and there was a note on my car that said, take your ass back to Las Vegas. And he's like, I sat there and cried for about 45 minutes, and then when I got back to practice around my guys, like, it was okay. And I gave him the man in the arena speech, and hearing that, having played, you know, quarterback at a little high school in Racine, Wisconsin. And I walked back out after halftime, and we were stuck because the pom-pom and cheerleaders were doing their thing. And we're standing in the middle of the opposing team's parent section, and people are like, 11 is saying you suck. And, you know, at that level, I can only imagine the stuff that you heard, you know, when you're playing, and you get resilient to that. Here's this young kid. He's 16, 17 years old, and he's having to get thick skin quick. People at home don't realize the amount of pressure or stress that, you know, you had from through high school, through college, and then in pro. When you made the switch, so you went from Seattle to Chicago?
Chicago.
Yeah. And how did that all come about, and what was that like?
Yeah, I mean, I got traded. That was, you know, you show up and it's a bit of a media circus and a big press conference and stuff, but then you got to get to work. And it's another team that hadn't been winning. But it was a new start. And it felt kind of cool to go back toward home. Spent a lot of time in Chicago growing up and in college years. And I really was optimistic about how that was going to go, but that team wasn't ready to win, and I needed some support. And, that didn't last very long, but that's just life in the fast lane. And, yep. And you got to – you know, I don't listen to sports radio, and I don't read the articles. You know, I never have, like, good or bad. Like, I mean, all the way back to high school, like, I just don't even pay attention to it. I know what happened,
yeah,
and I don't need opinions, but I get it. And now, you know, I think the world's changed. I mean, now it's about betting.
Yeah.
And people are grumpy about how you scored. Not that you didn't score, but you ran it instead of threw it.
That's true,
fantasy,
right?
Stuff, and it's wild. So I think the guys, they just don't hear it, you know? Yeah. You can't live with it, you know? You have to ignore it and agree to ignore the praise as well and just kind of do your job.
Sure. When I got done playing football, I raced cars, right? And if I listened to any of it, I would get irritated, right? So you just have to shut it off.
Yeah.
And you have your inner circle, people that you know, just like if you're playing in the Bears and, you know, the line's a sieve, you can't be after the game and be like, the line sucked ass, no. You know, I got smoked, because you're done, right? And you couldn't jump out of a race car and say, hey, Thibodeau, you know, didn't change the $10 fuel pickup and the car ran out of gas when I was winning the race. So, you know, you have to withhold that. In Chicago, did the culture feel the same as Seattle? And you just couldn't, you know, you kind of feel like you're suppressed at that point, I would guess, because you're struggling with the environment around you.
Yeah, that's a great sports town. So it was a very different, especially NFL history and stuff that Seattle didn't have. Seattle started in 76. So people are very, you know, engaged and aware of what the team's doing. They're very enthusiastic about it. Not dissimilar for Philly or, you know, Boston, New York, plenty of big cities. But they just wanted to win so bad. And what I noticed immediately in Chicago was all the guys in the 85 team were still around. They were the ones on the radio. They're still the ones on the billboards and stuff.
Sure.
It was like we needed to turn the page. You know? and
the Super Bowl shuffle was over.
Hadn't won enough. And you know, Dave Wannstedt was the head coach. You know, Eric Kramer had gotten hurt the year before. He wasn't part of the team when I was traded. And then they signed him. And then really, for me, that was the worst thing that happened, because it divided the team. I think plenty of guys were ready to, all right, move on. Here's a different guy. But he had a bunch of friends and guys, and he'd played well there, but he had a back injury or broken back, I think. He just didn't seem like he was part of the future, but it made it really hard on me. Not that he was hard on me at all. I mean, we were fine. We competed, but we were fine. We hung out afterwards and stuff. But it just divided the locker room. I don't even know if staff really realized that, but it's what happened. And,
sure.
And, you know, when half the team's pulling for one guy and the other half's the other way, it's tough. And that probably happens a lot, but I hadn't seen it that way before. So we got off to a tough start and, you know, I didn't get to play much and just wanted out of there. It just wasn't much future there. It was tough.
And after Chicago, what was next?
Green Bay.
And you were there for a year?
Talk about a different culture. I mean, Brett had been the MVP a couple times. They won a Super Bowl, a recent one. yeah, I did a season and then a whole off season and through training camp, and actually in 99 played against the Jets in a preseason game, and then got traded to the Jets about 4 days later. So then I'm calling my wife. I'm like, honey, are you sitting down? This is because, you know, we're going from De Pere, Wisconsin to Long Island, you know,
right? Big change.
Big change. And so at that point, like, okay, now I'm bouncing around, but I couldn't control that one. It was a trade. And that was a good team, and they had a great season the year before. and I'm there for like a couple weeks, and Vinny Testaverde tears his Achilles, you know, in the first half of the first game.
Yeah.
Like, boom, you're up. And it was a totally new language, and everything was different. So that was a tough situation. I mean, I you know, glad it happened, I guess. I mean, I lived through it, but it was tough. And those guys expected to win, and that team was kind of good enough to win.
Sure.
But we had a few other pieces missing, and, you know, Bill Parcells is a tough guy. I respect him, but it was difficult. So, yeah, that was interesting. He retires at the end of that season, yeah, and tells the team that Bill Belichick's going to take over. And, like, the look on Bill's face was like, what? I mean, I think he already had the thing worked out with
New England.
New England.
Yeah.
And I'm like, I just want to go home. Like, yeah. I can't – like, everybody's cars are running, and we're in this team meeting at the end of the season like it always is every year. And we're like, I just want to regroup, you know. Yeah. So it was always fun to come back to San Diego after those tough things at the end of the year, like just regroup.
Were you living here then?
Yes.
Yeah. When did you have the epiphany to make such a great life decision to move here?
Actually, at the end of Seattle, we still had a house there for another year, but like after my playing time in Seattle, between there and Chicago, we came down here and had a place in Del Mar just for kind of for off season, but just for who, you know, no kids yet,
yeah,
no idea, just liked it, and it was, you know, still west and warm, and we haven't found a way to leave in all these, you know, whatever it is, 25 years later.
Yeah, it's a great city. I mean, you know, not to diverge too far, but if people haven't visited here, you have to visit San Diego. I mean, you know, you look at a patrol car and it says America's finest city, and
yeah,
I don't think anybody that's here would ever disagree with that.
No.
So where were you on 9/11? Where were you playing?
San Francisco.
How did that whole event, I mean, where were you when you found out? How did that impact you personally? Because, you know, people always say, older people, I knew where I was, yeah, when JFK got shot. I mean, I knew exactly where I was for 9/11. Where were you? How did it impact you?
It's funny when you asked that, because I was thinking year 2000 was my boy. We were just talking about how weird that was. And I was in New York when that happened, right? Midnight of,
yeah,
switching from 99 to 2000.
Yeah.
So I had to think about, yeah, we hadn't talked about 9/11 in a while, but yeah, San Francisco, big city. We're not too far from San Francisco itself, where we were living, and it was like, what's going to happen? We got to get out of here, or what? You know, what is the world going to shut down? Or
yeah,
people were hoarding things and stocking up on stuff. It was very, very strange, and yeah, I you hear all the horror stories about people that got stranded in places and had to drive across country, and it was scary.
Yeah.
It was awful.
Yeah. Yeah. I went to the Chargers game. I think the NFL shut down for a week.
Yeah.
And then I don't remember who the Chargers were playing, but, it was weird. You, like, the hair was standing up on the back of your neck. Like, they couldn't do flyovers.
Right.
The national anthem was different. You know, I think Flutie was playing, or quarterback at the time. He came running out with the American flag. And, you know, obviously a big military town. And I don't know how, why, but there was some iteration of a flyover, which there wasn't anywhere else. And, man, talk about emotional time. But resetting you of all the different things that are going on in your life when something like that happens, because nobody knew what was going to happen next.
No, I know, and it was terrifying, and stayed that way for a long time. But I guess the games continued, and you know, the New York teams, everybody's kind of feeling for them and in that city, and people most affected by it. But yeah, frightening, kind of little reality check, yep, for everybody.
Yeah. Getting drafted by a team that's struggling. You look at like an Eli Manning who chose not to play in San Diego, or a guy like Elway that, you know, in one way, shape, or form opted out of playing in,
mm-hmm,
Indianapolis. Would you have played cards differently looking back? Do you think those guys did the right thing, the wrong thing, or they were just different?
I think it was different. I mean, John had baseball. You know, he wound up playing third base for the Yankees instead for a little bit. I mean, that's pretty good.
Yeah.
Pretty good fallback and pretty good leverage. The Eli one kind of surprised me when it happened because I hadn't really seen that. It worked out for him and Phillip. I mean, it, you know, I think Phillip's better than no Super Bowls, but I mean, good career, unbelievable, you know, guy and great career. But I don't know. I mean, that's not my personality. I think I just wanted to fight for whoever wanted to have me.
Sure.
And that held up through all these. I mean, I had seven teams, and whatever needed to be done, that's the uniform I'm wearing. I'm going to try my best and do everything I can. And sometimes, some seasons, I'm running down on the kickoff team and scout just because I had fresh legs, like just a body, you know. Yeah. So you do all these crazy things that you never really, people don't see. You know, they need extra guys for, you know, helping out on scout in certain weeks late in the year. And it was fun to do it. And it was exercise. And we just kind of, you know, kind of do what you got to do. But, I mean, I had so many, you know, great wins and seasons that were full of, you know, a lot of great memories. Sometimes you got to suffer through some tough ones to really respect it. And it does make it make sense. But it's no fun going through the tough times, but everybody does it.
Yeah.
You just have to be able to survive it. And sometimes the way the operation's running, you may not be able to fix it fast enough.
Yep. Toughest time in the NFL that you had? Like, if you had to look and say, you go home and you're staring at the ceiling in bed, this sucks. Like,
The worst was with the Jets, we had our bye. You know, I'd been playing somewhere in about the middle of the season. We had our bye, maybe just past halfway through. And I finally felt like, and we won two or three of the seven or eight games I played, something like that, maybe less, but close. We had a bye. We had an extra practice, you know, like a little week. And I finally felt caught up. Like, I finally felt comfortable. We were playing the Colts. I want to say it was the Colts in New York. And at the stadium, Parcells tells me he's going to start the other guy. Oh, I've never heard of this happening. And I'm like, we're about to play a team that's not very good. I'm feeling good.
Yeah.
It's the whole thing's been tough. And I honestly thought he was not kidding, but I couldn't believe he was saying what he was saying. And no one has ever done that, where you prepare all this time with the reps and stuff. Yeah. And then
the other guy's not gotten the reps either, right?
No. And he, you know, nothing against him, but I'm like, you got to be kidding me. So I honest to God, almost left. I thought about leaving the stadium.
Yep.
And part of me wishes I did just to stand up for myself.
Sure.
But I didn't. And it was so confusing. The whole team's like, what is going on? Like, what are you doing? As the first offense runs out in the start of the game, I'm like, he's playing.
Yep.
So that was like the unthinkable. And
that's tough.
It was tough. I mean, I've been humbled enough, and it was like, really? I mean, what's this going to fix, you know? So, you know, I lived through it, and it was no fun. But that's, you know, just on a quick reaction, that's the part that felt the weirdest.
Yeah. What happened after that? How did you manage it? I mean, did you end up playing again there, or what was the?
I don't think I went back into a game for a while. I think Ray Lucas was the other guy playing, and things just kind of fell into place a little bit for him. So, but the season was kind of a loss. So I was only there that one year, and it was, I don't know, the year I got to live in New York, I guess.
Yep. How about high points in the NFL? What would you say is the?
Yeah, I think going to a Super Bowl. I was with the Raiders when we came here and played Tampa and got bumped, but like I really felt like we should win this game. We had a little distraction before.
Was that the center that ended up in Tijuana?
Yeah, that was tough, and I felt terrible for him and the whole situation. But that season was a treat. It was my 10th year to get into the playoffs and play the big games and see what that's like, and then, you know, advance and the whole madness of a Super Bowl. It was the last time I think that the Super Bowl was just a 1 week from the championship game, so it was quick. And it happened to be in the town I lived in, which was just crazy. So
did you stay at home or did you stay with the team?
Team, but I, you know, go home the first night, whatever that was, Monday or Tuesday when we came down, and then we had a kind of a short week, but, you know, stayed at the Hyatt there off the five.
Yeah.
Had a great week of practice and stuff, and the game didn't go great, but the experience was cool, and I just felt like everybody deserves to see what that's like.
Sure.
If you put in a decade of time, you ought to at least see it as a, in a uniform. But I think playing a lot in my first couple years and having the place go crazy because we were turning around a program that was really at the bottom, that felt more euphoric than anything else.
Sure.
But, you know, there's little other things that come along when you get to play. And, you know, we beat Denver when I was with the Jets. That one stands out because no one gave us a chance. And I played as good as I did that whole year. And everything, you know, kind of clicked. So there's lots of little stories. None of them, unfortunately, none of them are winning a Super Bowl or anything like that. But it's, you know, there's a lot of highs and lows. And just try to enjoy the highs.
That game here, if there wouldn't have been that distraction, you think the Raiders win that game?
I felt like it. I mean, it wasn't close as it turned out, so it's hard to argue that we were better. But, yeah, I felt pretty good. I think playing against Gruden was the problem, and he kind of had us figured out.
Yep.
So that maybe had nothing to do with the distraction. But, you know, what happened with Barrett, really, it just kind of took the wind out of guys. No one really wanted to admit it, but it was just weird.
Yeah.
It's like the unthinkable happened. And it puts people in a weird spot, and it kind of probably fueled Tampa.
Yeah.
Like, we got these guys, and
yep.
And they put it on us.
Yeah. You know, I was on a plane, of course, right, and the Wi-Fi sucks, but I was out of things to do. Battery's about to die on the phone, and an article had popped up, and it went through a couple of instances where the same thing had happened. There was a running back on the Bengals that kind of went off the rails the night prior to the Super Bowl Bengals lose. There was a safety on the Falcons that,
you Eugene know, Robinson.
Yep, yeah. And guy's married, goes out, gets in trouble, you know, the night before the game, and, you know, Falcons lose. And that kind of distraction, I think, you know, when everybody's got their shields up, yeah, and you've got the media's all over you and you've worked the whole time to get there, man, that is a tough thing to get through, and for the individual, it's a tough thing to recover from.
Yeah,
right.
It's hard to go back to the team, and I mean, he came back and apologized in the spring, and it just, but he never played again. It was like damage was done.
Yeah, you know, like a Bill Buckner thing. It's just a mistake. It's an error on the field. Everybody's got the Favre, you know, playing at Minnesota, and he's rolling, and he can run for the first down, and he throws the ball across his body, and they, you know,
yeah,
stuff like that happens, but the off-field stuff is tough to swallow, and especially as a teammate, and they got to go out there and play the game. And when you start losing, you can't help but that come to the front of your mind, I would guess.
Yeah, it's terrible. I mean, I hope we don't see more of those, but I feel bad for those guys.
When you look at football today, NFL, like, or I got one more question, NFL. I guess first is, when did you know you were done, where you didn't want to play anymore, or where you couldn't play anymore? What was going through your mind?
I think my last year was in Detroit after a couple with the Niners and a couple with the Raiders. And, you know, I was the veteran guy, more of a coach really than a player, sort of, because we had a young Joey Harrington was playing, and he was kind of the franchise. That didn't go much longer, but at the time he was the guy, and that was not a debate. So I had a bad elbow. I wasn't like burned out all the way. I just was kind of like, this just feels like it's time.
Yeah.
And honestly, I was comfortable with that. Done after that season. Didn't say anything. It's not like an announcement, but it's like there is a formality to it with the league. And sure enough, Jeff Garcia hurts his knee. I think it was a preseason game or right, maybe first week the next season. And I get a call, and I'll never forget. We were at the racetrack, and it was in July. So it must have been early August, I guess. And how you doing? You working out? You know, we might need you. And I'm like, so I got all fired up, like, hey, maybe I'd give it another run. But it didn't work out that way. I think he healed pretty quick, and he's a warrior, so that's not that surprising. But yeah, I just, you know, once you're done and you're comfortable with it, I think there's just no looking back.
Yeah, yeah. Everybody's got that time. Football for me, I was never good enough to play at high enough level to where I had to make that decision. It was made for me, right? Like, yeah. Another sport beckons at a certain point. When I was racing and I got done, I pulled off the track last race and stopped before I rolled up to the pit box and just sat there for a minute, and I was like, I knew I was done. You know, I didn't have the burn to do it anymore. And that was one of those things, you know, similar to football, is part of the process of that is, you know, you take a beating physically, you take a beating mentally, and a different level of commitment, and I was done. You look back at support structure, you know, you've been married how long?
29 years almost.
Yeah. I mean, what credit do you give to your wife of always providing that level of support? Because nobody talks about family, NFL families that manage to survive the league, more or less thrive.
Oh, it's unbelievable. Yeah, I mean, geez, I've heard a fraction of the stuff she's heard as far as just the brutal, you know, comments and things that happen throughout, you know, downtimes. But yeah, just dealing with the ups and downs and the emotions of a season, all those seasons. Yeah, they don't get enough credit. And not every guy has a great support staff or a spouse. I have the best, so I'm very, very lucky, and she knows I know it. But, yeah, it's a huge part of the mental health stuff and just your psyche overall. You know, how do you come back from – and how do you keep them from going crazy when it's going too good? You know, like, there's a lot of balance that has to happen. But yeah, we're a good fit, I've been lucky to have it, you know, have that part ironed out. I mean, there's a lot of guys that go through a lot of drama off the field, and I haven't had to do that. And a lot of that's her, and sure. Kind of keeping me straight.
Now that's, you know, to her credit, I've only met her topically, but I mean, I know the challenges there, right? We've had multiple guys that are retired SEAL team members, not retired, former, and they struggle in that space too. You're gone for 9 months, you come back. It's different, but the load on a marriage is much different than it is in a traditional guy that is a plumber or, you know, works at Qualcomm or, you know, has a Subway franchise. It's a whole different level of pressure and stress.
I think we've moved 19 times.
Wow.
I mean, you just bounce around. There's a lot of moving parts.
Yeah.
Yeah. And yeah, I mean, that, you know, there's something to be said for that, like surviving all that.
With confidence is a big component, whether it's vocationally, whether it's relationships, whether it's sports or anything else. How did you keep your confidence up through the rough times and from letting it get too big during the positive times? You know, there's internal, external confidence. If I'm like, Rick, you had a great career, and I tell you that 100 times, it's great. But if all of a sudden somebody says, hey, you suck, right, when you have a challenging game, the internal confidence got to take over. How did you manage that when you look back at it now?
Yeah, I mean, there's definitely times, and I think everybody would agree, like, you don't have a lot sometimes. Like, it's you have reasons to believe you're in a bad way. And I mean, I play a lot of golf. I mean, it's kind of like, and I watch a lot of the tournament this weekend, and everybody hits bad shots. Like, sometimes you just, you know, it just doesn't work. It's just, can you fight back, you know, and can you hang in there? And like, over time, do you win the battle? And, it's a struggle. I mean, it's, sometimes you got to win ugly. Sometimes you need to get lucky. You know, there's a lot of different things, you know. I would say football is the ultimate team game, and there's a lot of things that happen that affect one guy, but he had nothing to do with how it played out. You can't throw it and catch it, you know, whatever. But there's a lot of things that have to go right for guys to look good, and just pure ability doesn't always solve it. Certain positions, it can certainly make a bigger difference, but we were so – you know, we relied so heavily on everything around us and getting into the right play and having everything work. You know, it's tough. Sometimes your confidence gets shaken and you got to bounce back.
Yeah. I mean, nobody can say somebody that's gone through, you know, your career path, not resilient, right? You have to be. It's not even a question. When you played best athletes as a spectator looking at it, and you're like, you know, Deion Sanders and Bo Jackson during that period of time, who stands out in your mind as being like, I don't want to say men among boys, but was a standout in the NFL that you played or you were around?
Terrell Owens first. I'd say Bryant Young too. I mean, just different bodies, but just athletically like sound. But the thing with T.O. is he also really wanted to embarrass the others. The DBs, like it was personal, and I love that about him, you know. And we were in San Francisco together, and he wasn't really a big deal yet, you know. That came a little bit later, and then he's got a lot of, you know, there's a lot of drama and stuff that's happened over the years. But the dude was a fighter, and he was gifted in ways most guys weren't. There's other big receivers, but he was just a mismatch.
Yeah. No, I mean, he's still now when you see him on one of these shows, like he's just ripped, right?
It's unreal. Yeah.
So your son plays football, and you know, he's a collegiate athlete now. Back in the day, there was no NIL, there was no portal. You know, you couldn't change schools. You had a good college experience. You take a guy like Troy Aikman that went to Oklahoma, and they're like, hey, you're going to throw the ball, and he gets there, and they run the wishbone, he breaks his leg, and he's got to sit out that year, sit out the next year, switch, lose eligibility. What do you think about the NIL stuff now, athletes getting money and the transfer portal from your perspective?
Well, they're two different things. I really don't like the NIL piece because I don't think there's any way to control it. And you know, a little something, you know, I don't know, defer money to these guys. Like if it was put away or there was limits to it, you know, that would make sense. I think you inducement's the big word, and this is pay to play in a lot of cases, and it's just ugly, and I'm not a fan. Transfer portal, I think, can be fixed. Give a guy one time.
Yeah.
I don't even mind the don't miss, you know, used to have to sit out a year. I mean, don't, that's fine, but, you know, you can do it once. You can't do it four times.
Right.
Or whatever, twice even.
Yeah.
But put some sort of rules around it, unless no one thinks there's a problem. But it bothers me when I see a kid that goes somewhere, he commits, he does everything the right way, he's halfway through college, and then they bring in this other guy and he just jumps right in front of him. I don't know. I'm all about competing and in open competition, but it's free agency. It's professional sports.
Yeah. I agree with you on both fronts. I didn't really think about though the portal. I always looked at it as from the athlete or the kid perspective is, oh, well, that kid got a scholarship. He was there 2 years and then decided to go somewhere else after they invested in him. But I didn't really think about the fact that colleges can go and pick these kids up, especially with the cash that can float behind the curtain, right? And you can bring somebody in and put them in front of the kid that's been working his ass off for 3 years and has actually done pretty well.
Yeah.
So that's true. What would you think about for NIL, almost like a 529 college deal?
Yeah.
Where let's say little Billy is going to get $500,000 this year, and you know he gets $2,000 a month. Because he's playing, he gets to keep that. The rest of the money gets deferred and put into an account. It could even be the same list of instruments or financial instruments that are 529. They could call it a 530 or whatever the hell you want to call it. Money goes in there, and he can't touch it or, you know, do anything with it until he gets out. And the university has to match another 20% as a bonus when he gets his diploma. Something like that. Do you think that would work?
I think it's better than what we have now. I don't know if it's going to change that much. I hope it will. We haven't done this long enough to see the horror stories yet. I mean, I think they're coming, and I don't know. You know, a lot of kids go in the portal, and there's money moving them from one school to the other, and then maybe they don't play. Well, what happens to the guys that never – I mean, we don't have all that data yet.
Yeah.
It hasn't been long enough. So it doesn't work out for everybody, and, you know – recruiting is recruiting. I mean, I get it. Everybody wants fancy facilities and all these different things that they can offer this kid. But school ought to be some of it.
Yeah.
You know, and loyalty ought to be some of it. By the way, you're not paying to go to school, and that's not inexpensive these days. And you do need to consider that some form of payment. I mean, even though other schools are going to offer you the same thing. But, yeah, if you could just protect them, like some annuity or some way to make it, you know, I mean, the NFL has a cap.
Yeah.
But this thing doesn't.
Yeah.
I don't understand how that can be.
Now, I 100% agree. And if you think about, you know, you get a left tackle is getting paid X, you know, which he might be getting hamburgers at the place for free, and then you get a quarterback's making $1 million.
I know.
It's got to tear the team up a little bit on internally. Now, that happens in the NFL, but everybody's a professional, right? I think one thing reason that people love professional football is when there's a fumble, you can't tell the guy that's making 800 grand or the guy that's making 55 million. They're both going full balls after the ball, right? Yeah. But I think, you know, you're going to see changes, and you're already seeing it with like USC and UCLA leaving the Pac-12 and going to the Big Ten. You're not going to have 20 teams that are really in the top 20. You're going to have four teams and then a bunch of others, or five teams and a bunch of others. So did you ever have any doubts about your kids playing football, safety wise?
I haven't. No. I understand it. I would be, you know, my boys have had injuries, not head stuff. And I've seen a lot of people have, I mean, I watch a lot of stuff on TV and hear about it, but, I don't know. I guess because I did it and I lived it and survived, I think you got it. There's a way to do it and be fine. But I can understand the concern a lot of people have, and there's plenty of other sports you could steer a kid toward that are fine too.
Yeah. No, I agree. I mean, and I'm not saying that my kid plays football, right? My older kid played hockey, and you know, you look at on Friday, there was an announcement, you know, I think it was an ESPN article, but the NFL came out and said, hey, concussions are up 18%. And this is after all this money's been spent on helmet safety and all the rule changes. The game's completely different in terms of what you could do to the quarterback, what you could do to a guy coming over the middle, hitting guys out of bounds. I mean, there's so many different things from the game perspective, but a safety perspective. So to see that kind of an increase, and I mean, we're obviously in the safety business, and you know, there's only four football helmet companies, and you know, it's a struggle to break in because people are like, we care about the athletes, we don't want to see these kind of injuries. They're wearing helmet X, but we're not interested in you know, helmet Y. And some of it is, hey, you know, your helmet doesn't look cool enough, or it doesn't pass this lab test, or whatever. And you know, we're going through that migration right now. But the game of football, at least when I look at my kid, the confidence that it's built, the ability to work with all different people, the ability to have grit and resilience, to build that internal confidence, I don't think there's any game like it. I certainly, even at the low level that I played, am the benefactor of that. And the fact after going through, you know, a long and illustrious career in the league as well as in college, you're here and your boy's playing, and I've met your son. He's a quality guy, right? You know, and hats off to you and your wife and your extended family for doing such a great job with him. But I think it's a great game. When you talk to a parent and they said, hey, Rick, should I let my kid play football or not? What would your answer be?
I always say yes if you're concerned about the injury, but if the kid doesn't love it, then no. You know, I mean, you don't have to play.
Yeah.
I wouldn't encourage them unless they're asking, because it's a lot of time and it's a lot of hours of things that are uncomfortable. But I did a lot of years coaching Pop Warner little guys, and a lot of them aren't football players.
Yeah.
You know, it's good that they're doing it at that age, but they had to suffer. And it's not just the town we live in, but I think America, like, kids don't suffer that much.
Yeah.
You know, they're not uncomfortable and nervous very often. And not that you're trying to pick on anybody, but it's like, there's something to be a part of a team, overcome something that's difficult, learn from mistakes or learn from losing even. And it's not, you know, we did everything we could to protect these guys from each other, because that's what you're supposed to do. That's what the practice rules are for. Winning the games was a bonus, but, yeah, I mean, the satisfaction, these little guys who maybe didn't play much and they really didn't know what they were getting into, but when it was over, they were so proud, and they're a part of it, you know, and that's, I don't think you get that with a lot of other sports, and maybe you do with some, but it's different.
1,000% agree. Having done the same thing, the Pop Warner coaching, and you have had a chance to do a lot of different things, and you know, when you move, you throw away a lot of stuff. At least you always purge. The one thing I kept, and I still have it, is an envelope of notes, and not the one that just has like the two liner with the kid's name written on it, but where they actually write you a letter to say, hey, I was a kid at the beginning that I was 5 minutes late for practice, or I kept jumping off when the count got changed to two, and you made me go and put my hand on the garbage can for 10 minutes because I could keep running and I wasn't getting tired. But it does make a difference. It is such a great sport. So if the same parent came to you and said, my kid loves the game, and you know he's continuing to move forward, what does it take to be successful in this sport, at least at a college level, or potentially to put yourself in a position to play on Sundays?
I mean, it requires the right dimensions. I think first, do you fit the size kind of requirements? And can you get there if you don't? I mean, weight's a little easier than height to fix. But, I was around a good environment, a good culture, pre-high school, high school, college. And then it's kind of business, you know. Yep. You don't get to pick all the time. But when I was a free agent, I picked people that I wanted to be around and the systems I wanted to be around and the culture I wanted to be around. So, you know, at some point at that level, you do have some choices. But I just think being in a good environment and be around like-minded people, which is what I think is great about college. I mean, you commit to a school because of more than the football. It's, you know, the academics and some maybe the staff and location and all these things. Sure. So, you know, I had my most success when I was around people that kind of saw it the way I did and wanted to sacrifice together. It wasn't like we had a stacked team. I mean, there were other good teams.
Sure.
And we just kind of clicked. So, I don't think you can manufacture a star. I just don't think you can do it. You have to have the want. So if the kid's got the want, then go get it.
Sure. Last couple questions here. You know, you're a business guy now and run a winery, right? You're in that space. Mm-hmm. And you've got some other interests. How did football impact your ability to be successful in these other areas?
I think there's two things I talk about all the time about my business experience. One is communication. That's where you can really go sideways, and I hate bad communication. I want clear answers.
Yep.
I want quick answers. And the other one's leadership. Like, make a decision. Go. Boom. Right or left. Like, yep. Don't kind of hover. Give it some thought, but you got to make a decision. And I think that's two things that sports, not just football, but sports taught me without me even trying to learn. It was just happening. You don't have a lot of time to make decisions when the ball's in the air.
Yeah.
And, if you don't know what the other guy's doing, you don't have a chance. So the communication's huge. And those things kind of apply to everything I do and all this time later.
Yeah. No, that's a great answer. Last question, played at one of the most focused on colleges, played at the highest level in, America's sport, biggest TV ratings, most focus. What do you want to be remembered for collectively? You know, who's Rick Mirer? If you got to make a statement and say, here's my capstone in my chapter. What is it?
Good person, good dad, good husband. Those are a choice. Sometimes I don't have an Olympic gold medal I wouldn't think anybody would want to be known for something like that. Like what are you about? Like what matters to you? I don't need a lot of attention and I never looked for it, but like I kill for my boys. I mean, I would do anything that was required to help them. And I don't know. That just seems like it's that there's more to be proud of there.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. Now I think that's a great answer. You know, it's reflective of the guy that you are. Just reflective in your son that I've spent a little bit of time with. So congratulations on that.
Thank you.
I think that anybody listening to this, you know, there's a lot of good information when you have these conversations, right? Because we're not talking about X's and O's. You know, there's a little bit of that. But the reality is that, you know, life for everyone still comes down to, are you happy, the people around you happy, and your kids. So, you know, I appreciate you being here today and being so forthright, spending time with us. And, you know, look forward to seeing all your next chapters. I'm excited to see how your son does as he develops. And he's certainly got the height component in place. And, you know, we'll be cheering him on, you know, as he moves forward. But thanks again for being here. Thanks, everybody, for listening. And, you know, we'll get everybody back on in another week or so. Thank you.
Thanks,
Rick.